Hi, my name's John Smith and I'm from Soundfair Australia. I'm here today on behalf of Tinnitus Australia, which is an initiative of Soundfair Australia, with Miriam Westcott, an audiologist, Peter Salvaratnam, a physiotherapist, and Margaret Osborne, a psychologist, to launch a series of discussions around tinnitus that we'll be posting on the web over the next few weeks. I have tinnitus myself. I've had it for about 20 years or so. And this series will focus very much on the importance of how health professionals can work together to support people with tinnitus. We're filming this today on the land of the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nations, and we pay our respects to their elders past, present, and emerging. Miriam, would you like to tell us a little bit about how you got involved in working with tinnitus?
So an audiologist is the first port of call for many people with tinnitus because a hearing loss is, or a change in hearing is associated with the onset of tinnitus, so it needs to be investigated. As an audiologist, I've been working with people for over 26 years, initially at a not-for-profit organisation and for the last 20 plus years in my own private practice here in Melbourne. Tinnitus can cause confusion, distress. People can be given advice that's not particularly helpful. And I see a lot of anxiety and distress and trauma in my tinnitus patients. And over all of those years, in the thousands of tinnitus patients, I've tried to help cope with their tinnitus and habituate to their tinnitus. About 20 years ago, I was trained in TRT, or tinnitus retraining therapy, which forms the basis of my approach. Over the years, I have evolved perhaps a more holistic and psychological approach to tinnitus therapy, utilising CBT and acceptance and commitment therapy approaches, looking at each patient in a holistic and personalised manner, trying to identify what are the factors that might have limited their ability to spontaneously habituate to the tinnitus and the factors that might be causing such distress with regards to the tinnitus. I also specialise in the allied conditions of hyperacusis, subnormal sound intolerance, misophonia, another form of sound intolerance, acoustic shock, and triple TS. And these factors tie in with tinnitus and will be covered in future videos that we'll be presenting. As part of what I do, it's very important to work collaboratively with others. And I'm very pleased to be doing this, these series of videos, and to be working professionally with my colleagues here, physiotherapist Peter Salvaratnam and psychologist Margaret Osborne. So a team approach where we all work holistically together to support our patients has been really very helpful, where we all understand how we do work together to get the best possible outcomes and to support our patients on their journey towards being able to live with their tinnitus and live the best lives that they can.
Thanks very much for that, Miriam. Peter, welcome, and thank you for coming along today. It's unusual to have a physiotherapist involved in tinnitus, isn't it? I certainly would never have thought of going to a physiotherapist about my tinnitus. Can you tell us a little bit about your journey and how you got involved in tinnitus?
Thank you, John. Yes, physiotherapists have slowly come to the party. There are specialist musculoskeletal physiotherapists and others who have done a master's in relation to the jaw region who address patients with tinnitus. There are physiotherapists who have been trained under our Tinnitus and Tmj clinic who also treat tinnitus and hyperacusis patients. In my case, it has been a journey. I did a PhD research work on the spine and the nervous system, and one of my professors was a neuroanatomist, so he taught me about the brain and the nervous system, the spine, and the other one was a professor of psychology. And he made me aware, like Margaret, about how the human being is important and the emotions and anxiety. Then I came to a dentist and he said, what a waste of time doing a PhD. You know, most problems come from the jaw. So I started looking at the effect of the jaw region, which is called also the temporomandibular joint or TMJ, in relation to headache, migraine, and tinnitus. Then I've met wonderful people like Miriam and like-minded audiologists who made me really aware about tinnitus and hyperacusis, and made me realize that I had a role and physiotherapists had a role too. And in conjunction with that, we've also written a book on headache and orofacial pain, and one of the chapters is by Professor Stephen O'Leary, who's an ENT surgeon. And during the COVID period, we consulted a lot of patients with tinnitus hyperacusis who were very anxious, a very debilitating condition. And hence, I had to look at other strategies to help them. Traditionally, physiotherapists might look at the neck and the jaw and provide treatment, or they might provide management strategies. And in conjunction with Miriam and a few other audiologists, we commenced a tinnitus and TMJ program for these patients over a couple of weeks. And it looked at the neurobiomechanics of the person. We also commenced an innovative neural tapping program to help to calm the patient and also to help them to deal with it. We've also addressed a program called exposure therapy, which Miriam and I have been involved. I also do trauma counseling as voluntary work in Australia and overseas, and looking how we can help these patients in verbalizing their condition. We also look at other issues like how they're dealing with it and whether they're trigger point therapy or grounding strategies, and also if treatments needed, we would look at dry needling and laser. So overall, we look at a holistic aspect of managing these patients with the audiologists, with the psychologists, with dentists, and also with integrative medical doctors to make them aware that they can learn to manage it more effectively.
Thanks very much for that, Peter. I really look forward to hearing more about how physiotherapy can work with people with tinnitus in the rest of our series. Welcome, Margaret. Can you tell us a little bit about how you got involved in treating people with tinnitus, what your journey has been, and what the importance of psychology is for people with tinnitus?
Thank you, John. So I've come into working with tinnitus through two avenues. And the first is through my involvement with the Australian Society for Performing Arts Healthcare, or ASPA. And so ASPA's remit is to address the particular injuries and rehabilitation needs of performing artists. And it has a particular multidisciplinary focus, so being involved with GPs, physiotherapists, audiologists, ear, nose and throat specialists, and so on. Being involved in that society made me aware of the need and enhanced therapeutic outcomes of having the multiple perspectives. And my involvement with ASPA came about because of my work with music performance anxiety. So I've been researching and treating patients for over 20 years, particularly with anxiety and how to optimize performance outcomes and address anxiety issues. And so what I could also see in my practice were, not only with performing artists and musicians, but across the board, people were starting to present with anxiety and tinnitus also. And I could start to see some sort of common factors in their presentation. And it made me aware of some theoretical models that were also addressing that. And the way that I was aware of theory was my involvement with the second avenue of tinnitus work, which was through the Clinical and Music Neuroscience Lab with the School of Psychological Sciences at the University of Melbourne. And I had colleagues who were researching what were the things that were inhibiting people spontaneously habituating to tinnitus. And there were a number of predisposing factors. So first of all, someone would generally tend to have a heightened emotional arousal at the time they were starting to become aware of tinnitus. They would have an auditory sensitivity, and they would have auditory environmental cues that were quite extreme. So for example, with a musician, you have someone who's often quite highly anxious because of the need to achieve a high level of performance excellence pretty much all of the time in order to perform their job effectively. Plus, they also have an auditory sensitivity to being aware of sound and how their instrument pitches to the accompaniment that they're playing with, be it an ensemble or orchestra. And then also an environmental context where they're exposed to often because of their practice, rehearsal and performance activities, levels of sound exposure that are higher often than the recommended daily safe dose. And so all of you have this a predisposition to for musicians to have hearing loss and tinnitus issues. So they start to become aware of the hissing, the droning, and then this cues the emotional brain, maintaining factors of distress, of anxiety, perhaps low mood, that brings offline neurocognitive networks that are necessary to keep sort of overcoming and performing one's best. So they difficulties of planning and motivated goal-directed action. So ultimately then you have someone who presents to you who's behaving in a way that I guess looks like they're quite depressed, but they're just certainly not performing at the best of that they could be. So there are a number of factors, psychological issues at play when someone's having difficulty with tinnitus. And so as a psychologist, I can use methods such as cognitive behavior therapy or acceptance and commitment therapy to really help people manage the thoughts and behaviors that can lead to difficulties and disabilities with tinnitus. And as a psychologist, my therapeutic outcomes are enhanced when I'm working with audiologists such as Miriam or physiotherapists such as Peter, who are really aware of the psychological neurotags for anxiety in tinnitus patients.
Thanks very much, Margaret. It's great to know that by working together as health professionals, there are opportunities for people to actually manage their tinnitus better. But it really is that multidisciplinary approach from health professional that seems to be the key. We look forward to exploring these much more in the rest of the series. We'll be looking at causes and triggers of tinnitus. We'll have a general introduction about tinnitus from Miriam, and we'll be especially looking at treatment and management of tinnitus from an interdisciplinary perspective. Thanks very much, everybody. Mm-hmm.